And also, I'm a director over here, so I take care of these projects also. So I do both of the stuff.
Hello.
So let me just start by giving you first intro, because I think Harris is a new company. They want everybody to know about them. So I do the quick intro of my sponsors. Just like Thales right now, it's like a big company in 68 countries, and they are like good on sales, as you can see, they're like nearly 20 billion euros of revenue, and so they have a good R&D division. So that's good for us, so we can take through lots of R&D.
So we create more projects, do work on the abstract maths part, and then create new products. Then into like defense, space, aerospace, ground transportation, security, they're everywhere basically, yeah. So I think you'll find it in like they're part of the Rafael deal, they were part of the Delhi Metro, so they are just there everywhere. And there are lots of folks over here, like the guy Albert, he was a Nobel Prize physicist, he's also part of the group. So like we have got a good folks of people over there. So that was all my sponsors, like a commercial break. Let me get back to agenda. So yeah. So things probably I'm going to talk about. First, basically events is a very normal thing that's happening in the real world. I'll just talk about what events are. Then why do we need a sessionization basically, more from machine learning perspective? Why is it important? I'll first cover the traditional approach and then take some real world use cases that we found in the data. Then I'll talk about the applied data science way. So I agree with, I think you must have heard Grant Sanderson in the morning. So we should definitely first understand how things are actually, what's there in the real world, then understand the concepts and make it more intuitive to actually apply. So applied data science is basically mix of both the things. You know the maths, you may not be solving maths equations, but you know what to apply basically. So I'll cover the basic things first, and then maybe tell you a summary how to apply these techniques and solve some problems by simpler techniques. So it's a balance of both the approaches. So talking about events, events could be anything. It's a digital world, you know. So you could be having like orders placed in a financial market. There could be users tweeting on social media. Then there could be people clicking on websites, and like there could be events from IoT devices, events to a router. So anything that comes with a timestamp is an event. So any digital entity over the scale of time generating information is event basically. So you want to capture and understand these events. So that's the basic idea. And so as you can see, like in the digital world, you have like mobile devices, internet, IoT devices. So you'll get lots of information over here. And everything is like a stream coming over time. There would be an actor. Actor could be a user working on a website. There could be maybe a mobile device or some other device. So they all be generating information like bits of streams over the scale of time. So time is the most important part, because this comes on the scale of a time, and we need to somehow find a meaning out of that, find the information from it. So I'll give you a few examples how we can basically see information flowing over. So let's say we have an entity, one entity. It's generating some random events basically at some fixed interval of time. So most likely this could be a server on internet, like a DNS server, or maybe some other server which is doing a periodic health check with a master server. So that's a very organized time-based event patterns, maybe like a resolution query. That's one type of entity. Then second, you could be having a human. He's doing random things at random amount of time basically. So there is actually no real pattern in human behavior. Then let's say you could have one more user. He's also having some pattern, but it's possible there is also something periodic happening in between his activities. So there could be an time-based order, maybe like a bot also working from his identity. So there could be a machine who's using his identity and doing various activities. So there could be a mix of events for some entity. And there could be a pure like event which is very organized. If you see these arrows, all the these three sets of things are very time organized. You see the first event, second and third, that's what it's always happens. You see the same thing again, again, again. These are actually could be real bots. Maybe could be some malicious bots doing some activity which is probably not really intended to do something good things. So the idea is, how can we capture these patterns basically, understand various actors working on the digital world, and somehow create a signature. And these could be like good guys, could be bad guys, but if we can, by the help of machine learning, find those signatures and then their auto correlation, that would be a really important thing. So that's where we start with the concept that we can have two major things that we can call as a session. So session is basically a continuous activity of things happening. So I have like two views over here. One is like the operations view, which we normally deal with, like when we're working on a laptop. It's like a session, a web session. That's what we simply mean. So that's called we continuity in activity. So there's some like mean activity period, like we type for some time and then we leave that, again do some activity and leave a laptop. So that's some activity period. And whenever the gaps is more than the mean activity period, we say that was one session, another session, third session. So that's a normal meaning of a session basically, the any activity that's happening. Then probably there could be more time-based events which are happening. So it's possible in your history of data, you'd have seen something, multiple events of type A, B, C, or D. They were happening again and again in some basically time-based window. And this was window was seen again for different users, maybe different point of time. So all this was happening repeatedly. So from this, you can maybe do a time-based correlation and say that this event leads to second, second leads to third, third to fourth. So from a mixed of random events, based on their time occurrence and based on their sequence of occurrence, we could statistically found that yeah, they are correlated. So that's one way of finding correlation into multiple large amount of data. So, and most likely the humans would have some kind of random pattern, but the bots will have a more organized pattern. So the idea is how can we separate machines from humans and how can we better model the machine traffic in a more mathematical model. So that's the major idea, modeling machinic activity into basically some kind of a model where we can basically predict and where we can maybe find outliers, other things, do lots of things from this thing. So this could be like a chain of event, maybe like a web session activity, somebody logging to a server, opening a file, transferring a file. So that's one sequence of things that normally happens. So FTP server does it regularly. But if somebody attacks a network, he'll maybe use a different path. So the path would diverge from a known given path. So we can then find the deviations from a path. So there are multiple applications which can be used to then solve lots of cases like fraud detection, cybersecurity, and maybe other behavioral cases where you want to see how does a machinic behavior appear and how it's deviating. So these are multiple applications. But the core essential part is how can we find this chain based on the data. So that's the core emphasis. I'll focus on how do we actually discover these chains automatically. And there is another critical thing. If you have a chain, you can also find the root of the chain. So for example, if that was a malicious bot and it was a chain of event, like there, for example, that was like an FTP or telnet login, a backdoor login, and it's doing maybe opening a backdoor port and transmitting data to some other network. So it's basically stealing information. You want to stop that. So it's possible if you try to stop the first event, the chain may or may not stop. Like if you must have heard the lecture from Subhashish yesterday, so like correlation can be causality, but it's not necessary basically. So it can be a causal. So for example, the first event may be causal, and if you stop this, it's possible you stop the entire bot. That's possibility, but not necessity, because we are just observing data. Let's say for example, the bot was entering from a telnet session, but he could have another entry access basically like from SSH or some other things. So a chain of events may be correlated, it could be causal. So idea is you can try these things. So if you get a correlation of events in the order of time, then you know this is the root event. So if you find the root event, then you can try to basically block the root event and actually block the whole chain of events. So this could be maybe like a campaign on social media. You want to stop that. So like you have seen lots of malicious campaign happening. So if you can stop the originator, you can stop the entire chain. So it can be causality, may not be. So, but finding the chains is definitely important, and they gives a lot of information. But talking about real world, so the time periods between them, they'll actually vary. So that's how real world is. It's not really easy to model a real world. And that was, I guess, Vikas was telling in the previous talk, the all these things we do in a lab is pretty easier. But in the real world, things vary a lot. Those time periods will vary. The second event will come after maybe a long amount of time, sometimes shorter. So it's hard to model them. So to model a real world, what we say, add some kind of stochasticity. So let's say instead of having a period, let's learn a distribution for them between the variation. So the all these variations, maybe let's say modeled by a simple Gaussian distribution or any other distribution. So this can then be used as something called a stochastic period. So the notion is real world is dynamic, and to model a changing phenomenon and to basically connect a changing phenomenon, we need to have these changing periods also. So how we can model stochastic period. That's what probably I'll talk about in the next part. What's the maths behind this, basically, to find such a discovery. And we expect these kind of things would be more robust and applicable in real world, where we can find different kinds of chains, different kind of campaigns, bot activities, and we could also find this from a mammoth of data. So, and this would actually really help us find these interesting stuff, interesting patterns. Yeah. So, there are different applications, as I told you, in different areas of businesses. So, like, it's possible somebody's doing a market manipulation. So you can find this via these chain discoveries. So if you find basically how do you, some machine is making orders and trying to manipulate the market, you can discover those chains basically by those sequence of actions. Similarly for tweets, you have seen like political campaigns, like you must have seen the newspapers, like they were biased the political party, so they were biasing users. So there was already a program in the background who was analyzing activity and doing some actions. So you can find those chains basically using this analysis and see what is the originator. Then you can catch that and maybe stop that. Similarly for websites, you people may be doing transactions, account takeovers. They may be doing the same activity in a different way. So you can again find those chains. So there are multiple such applications. But the core remains how we can do a time-based correlation of these events and find those chains and find the root of the chain basically. So these are multiple applications. So the to convert this to a mathematical model, the first step is convert it to a pulse train. So for every event, for a particular user, so let's say we identified some entity. Entity could be a machine, a server, could be a user doing some activity, or some anything that generating events. So translate those to like a pulse. When we see the event, say a pulse one, and when we don't see, it's zero basically. So we get an impulse train. And now we can use mathematics to basically solve or answer this impulse train. There are lots of ways to basically finding such patterns. So I'll tell about theoretical ways. One is like using a Fourier transform. So using impulse train, you can find the Fourier transform and find the frequencies in that. That's one way. Then second is doing a stochastic period analysis, which I just told you. Look at the time periods, the varying time periods, and model the variation in those time periods. That's another way. Third is like basically using Gaussian mixture models. These are some more names which are used to basically model stochastic periods. And there could be more complex ways because sometimes the current techniques are not suitable. Like in Gaussian mixture models, you need to specify a K, like that's a parameter, and you don't know how many clusters are there. So like I was showing you an example with let's say four kind of relations them, but I don't know there would be four, five, or six. So that's why you can't tell the K beforehand. So there are more complex methods like infinite Gaussian mixture models, which can help us identify those patterns. So I'll just briefly cover these topics, and this will be going increasing out of complexity. Then I'll come down to applied data science. So just to summarize these techniques, I'm just plotting a small diagram. So as you increase the complexity, you get more information. Yeah. But eventually the technique becomes too complex. Like non-parameter Bayesian methods are really complex. Yeah. It's hard to do, but they are lots of information. They're very close to real world. They capture the uncertainty. But yeah, that's not easy to model. So we can do a balance. That's where applied data science comes in. So you can take some assumptions, maybe do a small ED in your data. And if the assumptions are true, then probably, yeah, directly apply those techniques. So in the end, I'll just summarize how you can quickly take a balance and some of the known techniques, apply it, and basically find the problem, solve the problem in a more easy fashion than doing all the complex techniques. So, but as I think like Grant Sanderson was telling in the morning, that we need to get the essence or the understand how things are working. So that's why I'll first cover these basic techniques, like what does a Fourier transform do? What's the intuition? So if you know the intuition of a Fourier transform, then maybe you can modify it or use a different way. Similarly, if you know the intuition of Gaussian mixture models, you can modify it. Similar goes for infinite Gaussian mixture models. So I'll quickly cover these topics in a brief introduction period. So that's what a Fourier transform does. If you look at this animation, this is a signal. It could be a mix of lots of signals. So idea is, can we find the original signals, like a sum of cos and sine signals? And so if we can just split this signal and take those basic frequencies out, that's what a Fourier transform does. And just note the period, at what time are they occurring, what the frequencies occurring. So that's what is simply a Fourier transform. So it's a simple intuition basically. So, and this gives us basically what's happening inside. So we are able to decompose a complex signal into simpler signals. So if there are multiple operations going on in a chain of events, then yeah, maybe this could tell us that, if that's a clean signal. So just talking about Fourier transform, it's the same thing. We have these sine and cos waves. We just want to find the coefficients. So the point is, if we know these coefficients, those were the vertical bars and basically the frequencies or strength of those basic signals. So that can tell us what are the frequencies operating in the complex signal. So the idea is simply basically, you have your function, that's ft, and then you have basically a periodic function, which we know is basically sum of cos and sine waves. So the idea of Fourier transform basically convert, map your ft to a pt, and in that process, discover those coefficients a and bn, like the values of the cos and sine signals. So that, in short, is a Fourier series. That's a quick intro. There are a few variants of these series. I'll just mention those also. So, and to also do this, there's a simple intuition. If we want to, like in a simple machine learning model, we want to train something. We have a label and we have a data. So we simply do make an error function and do a difference from that. So this is the function we want to have, and this is the model function. So y minus y hat gives us the error. And the root mean square error is a term we want to optimize basically. It's a simple machine learning problem that we solve. So the same thing applies here also. What we do analytically, find the derivative, equate to zero. If you equate to zero, you'll simply just get these formulas. And this is what the Fourier transform does internally. So it's simply basically mapping your signal to a known signal, finding the errors, and basically setting those to zero to find the coefficients. So this term over here, the A0, is important, because if you see, it's like this integral of a signal over a period. If you have a periodic signal, it will give you the mean value of that. And this is important because when you look at a Fourier transform, the zeroth frequency would be a very high peak from the other peak. So you should know that this is the mean of the signal, and maybe you should remove that and look at the other frequencies. That's more important. So this was for a time period 0 to t. That's what is a Fourier series. And there is a compact way to say the same things. So there is something called an Euler's formula. So you can represent both cos and sine using complex numbers just by using a simple expression called e raised to power j omega t. So you can write the same formula in a complex form, let's say cn and ej omega t. So now you need to find only one coefficient that could basically give you the relative strength of those signals. And the Fourier series basically just the same thing in a time period 0 to t. If you change this time period from t to infinity, that's a Fourier transform. Just the same thing, but the time period is not just limited. It could be expanding to any point of time. And this is like CTFT or a continuous time Fourier transform to basically look at a continuous signal. There is a simple discrete version of that. That's called the DTFD, discrete time Fourier transform. And this is the one we will use to analyze impulse trains. So because events are discrete events, so something happening on internet happens at some random point of time. Some other event happens at some other point of time. So this is like a discrete time event happening, and this is helpful in analyzing those events. So I'll just explain the same thing via a diagram. So let's say we have a simple impulse train. So this is like a 10 second pulse. Every 10 seconds you're getting a pulse. That's a very simplest function we can have. And if you take a Fourier transform, the real part tells you about the magnitude of the signal, and the imaginary part tells about the phase shift. So if you noticed, like the gaps are over there just like 10 seconds each, and the frequency peak is at 0.1. So 1 by 10 is 0.1. So frequency is basically 1 by time period. So Fourier transform simply tells us the time period that's in operation in that signal. So that's one easy way of finding the frequency that's operating in the original signal. So, and just to tell you what I'm plotting over here, it's a simple Fourier transform of signal. Just use a NumPy library, take a Fourier transform, and use the absolute part, because we just want to look at the magnitude. Where is the frequency peaking in? And the first half is the positive frequency, second half is negative. So just plot the first half, and that's what you basically are looking or bringing in that diagram. And so, and frequency bins are basically just the inverse of the time periods. So now you can actually see and understand what we are plotting. So I'll take some case studies. So this is like a public data set. It's called CTU13. If you just Google it, you'll easily find it. So this was done by Czech Technical University. They actually ran a malware in their own network. And that was something called like a Dawn bot. That was the malware they simulated. and it basically attacks a Windows SVC services. So this data is available, you can try it. So I'll just show some real examples how I can actually use the real data to find those events happening in the background. So this is a case one. So this actually real bot activity. So this bot was basically deployed in the university and it was trying to contact the DNS server of the university. Look at this pattern. So it's a simple impulse chain. Whenever the bot raises a DNS request, we just say it's one, otherwise it's zero. So as you can see, it's kind of organized. So bots normally have an organized pattern. So there's something called a beaconing. So they send beacons basically to check what's happening. So they are checking with the DNS server of basically what's happening, not happening. Sometimes they are short time period, sometimes they are even. So if you take a Fourier transform to understand a signal, so the normal transform would be really messy. It's really hard to understand. So if we zoom it a bit, then we can see something interesting. So I showed the previous one, because if you just look at this transform directly, it may not be meaningful. But zoom it a bit, and you need to then figure out how to zoom in basically to how much area. That comes from experience. Like for example, if you see like these are a 15 minute interval, I can see three bars in 15 minutes. So approximately 5 minutes is basically one interval of this thing. And 5 minutes, 300 seconds. So 1/300 is approximately 0.0033. So if you see the peak over here, it's very close to that, 0.0033. So it's just ahead of 0.0025. So just by intuition, you can discover that yes, there's actually a periodic signal and you're seeing a peak at that. And there's a property of Fourier transform that the frequency and its multiple will show the same peaks. So you're seeing multiple peaks over here in this chart, but they're also the same frequency, 0.003, 0.006, 0.009, and it goes on. So, but this signifies only one single frequency. So because it will repeat at the multiples. And this is the phase shift. I think this is very negligible because it's mostly periodic and in sync at the zero. So this is a one way of looking at it. Let me also now use the same example to introduce the second way of looking at things. That's the stochastic period. The first was the frequency way. Now basically look at in the time domain. So in the time domain, we look at the time delta, simply subtract the time stamp, as simple as that. You get a signal and do a time delta and you will basically get deltas. The delta will vary a lot, but that's okay. And if there is a periodicity in the signal, the time deltas will vary in a band. So that band is of interest to us basically. And maybe we can somehow plot a density distribution of the time deltas that will give us like how much they are varying. Are they varying in a small range or a larger range? So, and we can then probably learn a probability distribution out of that. So that's other way of handling or looking at these time events in the time domain itself. So let me show the same example again. So what I've done over here, the same thing, I'm just finding deltas of that. Every consecutive bar, the difference is plotted over here. So if you see a difference of 300 mostly, so it's varying around 300. The difference is very small over there, small over here. So we have very small delta over here basically. So this is just a plot of delta by the same activity. But if you notice the delta graph, it's actually mostly lying in a band. So majority of these deltas are in a band. And as we can see, the signal is actually very close to periodic. So that's why it's a band, but it's varying a bit in the band. It's not exact. If you find the exact period, you won't find it. But yeah, so what we can do, we can find the mean of this band simply. And that will give us the mean period of how this band is basically centered. And then we can also find the standard deviation of this. And standard deviation can also be used to define a property that's called periodicity. So we can say like when you have a normal series, so we have something like a coefficient of variation. How much is that my distribution varying? So that score tells me the property of the distribution. So inverse of that could be periodicity. So that means is the band very narrow or is basically too large? So is the signal really periodic or is just noise? So this is like a score, a dimensionless number. That score can tell us is the signal was really periodic or was really noise. So these like properties on this band can help us analyze that signal. And then based on this, you can also find sessions. So for a continuous activity in that same band, you can have one session. Another continuous activity, you can have another session. So based on the continuity of these time periods, you are able to find multiple sessions, all based on timestamp. So we are just looking at the timestamp and that's it. We don't care about the event or what other relation it was. Just based on the occurrence of timestamps in the time axis, we can get information. So if we just expand this further, if we just do the same histogram of that, this is like a density plot from the histogram, and as you can see, most of the these time deltas are in the range of 300. So you see a peak over here that's in the around 300. It's more looks like a Gaussian distribution. So this we can use, and this would be like a PDF or the definition of a stochastic period. Like this probability density can explain the variation in that signal. So that Don Watt's DNS queries are basically can be modeled by this simple Gaussian distribution. We can find the mean and sigma of that. So those two variables are now good enough to describe the DNS queries of a Don Watt. So the same histogram I've done with a more detailed one, it's the same thing, but it's a more detailed basically. So we are zoomed in a bit and it's more coarse. That's a more smoother version of that. So, but yeah, you can clearly see a PDF coming out of that. So this is one simpler way, just find your deltas, and it's easy to find a delta basically. Subtract the two numbers and you get a PDF. And PDF you can represent by a mu and sigma. So just by two numbers, you can compress a whole information in a PDF. So that's one way. I'll take more examples to illustrate the same point in both frequency and time domain. Yeah. So I'm mentioning again example. So this is actually a real attack. This is a blacklisted IP. So this IP was blacklisted sometime 5 years ago because Don Watt was very popular at that point of time, and it used 5600 backdoor port to actually transfer data from somebody's laptop to other server. So this is a very activity. It's like in a span of 2 hours. So it contacts to the master server and then basically transfers data very frequently. So this is a very complex. If you look at delta, it will be more simpler. So again, if you see, there is some kind of pattern over here in its activity on the time scale. There are some high peaks, some low peaks, but majorly there's not really too much of a variation. It's in some kind of band, you can still find it. So in this band, majority of the activity is still available. But there is more interesting thing in this. Let me take another diagram. So the same band, we can also find a Fourier transform of this. So if you see, we have a very large peak in the beginning, and because of that, the whole signal got compressed. You can't look at the other peaks. There are some peaks, but they're very small to understand. So because the first zeroth frequency is the mean of the entire signal, as showed in the formula earlier. So idea is simply just take out the first frequency. The moment you take out the zeroth frequency, you see a very nice pattern coming out over here. So these peaks are indicating what's happening inside the signal. So as you can see, these peaks are also again at the same point, like 0.025, approximately 30 seconds. And this band is also around 30. So as we can see, Fourier transform is able to find those fundamental frequencies operating in the signal. Now let's look at the same signal from a time delta point of view. So from time delta point of view, again, we plot the histogram and density graph. We can see a single peak over there. But there are multiple ways of looking at a particular data. So like even density plots are biased basically, or histograms are biased. So I can have a different smoothing thing and get a different view. So like even the same diagram, actually it may not be one band. It's possible it could be two bands. See the blue and the green. So that there is a top frequency and there is a lower time delta. If we zoom in a bit, we can see like two clear Gaussians over here. So it depends on how do you plot a PDF. So depend on granularity, you can see multiple different bands coming in there. So it's subjective to how do you interpret it. So that's why you need to be cautious to see, are you doing a smoothened version of that or having granular version? So maybe this could be making more sense in this case scenario. It could be like an interaction. So if you can say like this is one stochastic period and like this is the another stochastic period. So this is just like interaction of two stochastic random variables, and we are just seeing a continuation of these. So it's like a continuous chain of interactions. And this is one way of looking at this. So this is one activity. I'll show you more examples like this another case. So this was like a genuine systematic DNS query. This is the time pattern looks really complex, just a mix of signals. If we look at a delta, the delta is really interesting. There are only 4 levels in the delta. So if you can see, and those delta are very equally spaced. They're actually multiples of 8. So the first delta is like 0.8, then 1.6, then 2.4, then 3.2. So it's actually a DNS phenomenon happening. So you have them like called a recursive DNS query. If you're able to resolve a DNS query, you answer back. If you are not able to resolve, you send to some other server basically. So based on where were you able to resolve that DNS query to the IP address, you will have multiple time bands. So a normal query will have multiple these hops. So that's why you have like a multiple of these. But from a mathematical point of view, you can just see four bands in operation. So even if you don't know the logic of DNS, we can still figure out how does the DNS works because of this mathematical formulation. So if you look at the Fourier transform, this would be interesting. Now, because I'm showing you more complex cases, so the Fourier transform has a limited utility. Now if you see, I can see a peak that's nearly around 0.24. That's a very high frequency, around like 4 hertz. So, but that signal is not even part of this. In this small range of, let's say, 2 seconds, I can see a maximum 3.2 gap. There is a bigger gap of 4 seconds. That's not even in this Zoom session. But Fourier transform is only able to catch that part. It's not able to catch the lower frequencies. So that's why probably we are able to get a limited information Fourier transform. So this is good for your transform, but yeah, it may not be good for all the cases. You need to go to more complex cases and more higher forms of modeling. So I'll just show you the same thing in a time delta perspective. Again, as you can see, I can model in two ways. If I do a smoothened version of that, you could have a single PDF. But it's possible, it's actually four PDFs in action, or like four random variables interacting with each other. Let's say call them A, B, C, and D. So it's basically, you can see it goes from A to B, B to A, and you can get a chain of things basically, B to C, C to D. So you can get like the transition probabilities of each of these events. So now if you model the whole DNS system as a state system basically, of four states. So all this happening is basically hopping from state A to B, B to A, then C and D, sometimes between. So these four states can summarize the entire signal and that complex DNS logic in this state diagram. So this is a way of compressing information in by time-based correlation and modeling it into like a simple state machine. And you can then use like Markov chains to see is the transition probability normal or is it going out of unexpected things. So you can also find the deviations from these kind of chains. So but this is one way of modeling it. Yeah. So I'll just show you one more example. It's like a more interesting pattern. So if you see the deltas over here, even they have a varying pattern, like a sine and a cos wave. So this is like two signals in operation. And this can be captured from the imaginary part of the Fourier transform. If you see, there is a peak at a very exact frequency 0.1. So at every 10 seconds, those two signals are mixing. And they are basically of different phase. That's why you even see a sine and cos going in. Every 10 seconds, it will complete a cycle and you'll get a new pattern. So there are multiple ways of interpreting it. So these are like nice techniques to find those patterns and model them mathematically. Yeah. But more generically, the time deltas is a more better way to model them. And then you can have these PDFs. And if you can find those each of these peaks, then yeah, you are able to define one phenomenon or one stochastic variable. So, but the problem is basically, how do you find the right PDF? As I was telling you, there are different views. You can have a zoomed in view. You can have a coarse view, a smoothened view. So which is the correct one? We don't know. So and how do we discover automatically? So that's the key. And the next part of session is basically how do you find these the right ones of these PDFs to model the right phenomenon. So that's the idea. Auto-discovering these distributions because it's subjective to the level of your zooming. We want to find the best one so that we can make it automate the system. We don't want a human interaction or like a human analyzing these plots. We can do it by validation, but we don't want that. So simple idea is, let's say you have a set of points. You want to, let's say, model them by some PDF. So you want to, let's say, have split into two PDF or two histograms. And that's the idea. So one thing is, you can do it like by a clustering. It's a simple clustering problem. It's a one-dimensional data. If you do a clustering, something like a DB scan, and you'll get clusters. There's also techniques called like Gaussian mixture models. It will basically give you two Gaussians, as simple as that. You tell, you need to specify the K for this. If I can give k equal to 2, it will give me the two PDFs, as simple as that. So this simple thing works, and I get the PDFs back and the one which I wanted. It can also do for two-dimensional also. So these are the contours. So contours are the same PDF. If you just project the PDF down, so the peaks have smaller circles, and when you go down, you have a bigger circles. That's what it's telling. The centers are probably there in the centers. So this, again, can be modeled by Gaussian mixture models in two dimensions. So these are techniques easy to basically model. So we can find these PDFs if we know the K. So that's the important part, knowing the K over here. So I'll also give the intuition behind Gaussian mixture model so that how we understand how we can modify it also. So it's a variant of k-means. K-means is like doing a hard clustering of points. This is like doing a soft clustering of points. So, and these like, this is the points that we are happening. So it will give probabilities instead of the exact labels. So I think this is probably, we need to define k over here. So this is a hard problem. So that's where the next level of things comes in. This is all pre-built, but there are also some heuristics like elbow method, Selhaute to find the k. But these are like very manual things, or they can't be automated. So that's why it's a hard problem. So they, I think you can move to the Bayesian world. So I think you must be knowing it. This in the Bayesian world, this is like the prior, this is the likelihood, and then probably this is the evidence, and that's how you basically do a Bayesian setting. And that's the, you get a posterior. Similarly, there's some properties of Bayesian properties. Yeah. So if you have like a prior and the posterior of the same family, you can call them conjugate. Yeah. So these are some properties of Bayesian we can utilize. And I think this is some example. We can skip these things. This is an example of a conjugate basically. This, how do you construct GMM? I think this is a parametric setting. We define the K and these are the parameters. Like the, we first choose which of the cluster you want to pick the point from, and then choose basically that Gaussian. Gaussian is again the mu and the sigma. So it's a set of basically two properties. Choosing the cluster, that's a set of pi's, and then the Gaussian properties. So that's how this GMM works. You can maybe model like a latent variable. So basically T first lets you choose a cluster and then you find the Gaussian. These are the equations, again, you can easily find on internet. So this is the function. Training is basically a simple thing. Just maximize the likelihood. You can easily find those things. It's a EM algorithm, it's like simply like a k-means. So in the E step, you first find the distribution of these clusters. So like you find, associate each point to a centroid, that's doing the first step of k-means. Second, you update a centroid. It's similar over here. So it's a similar analogy of k-means, but it's doing in probability domain. So I'll just skip this part. Then come to the main thing we want to solve, because this sessionisation we want to do in the real world, and there would be lots and lots of users basically over the internet, over the enterprise network. So there could be millions of entities. So we can't do it manually. We want an automated method basically. So the stochastic period we want to discover by a automated clustering technique. And as you see, GMM and on K means they require the K. We can't automate them. So that's where the next level of things comes in. These like the more complex levels, like the infinite Gaussian mixture models, where you can actually have infinite Gaussians in it. These are a class of Bayesian non-parametric approaches. So there's a lot of bit of maths behind it. I won't go into the maths, most of them, but quickly give an intuition. So to begin enter these, we use probabilistic programming. And to understand that, let's use a very simple example, like a logistic regression. That simple equation, use a sigmoid, use a weights, and multiply it with the data basically. In a Bayesian world, you convert the betas from a scalar number to a distribution. So now those weights are no longer numbers. It could be like a distribution having a mean and a standard deviation. So that's a Bayesian setting. And in a Bayesian setting, you can basically now use sampling. So in a Bayesian world, you sample from a distribution, and techniques like MCMC gives sampling, which gives you the estimates of those parameters. So like, you know, you get a Gaussian for a beta 1, Gaussian for a beta 2. So that's the idea in a Bayesian world. And what's the benefit? Like in a normal sigmoid, you just get the value of the sigmoid, the probability. Now you also get a band called a credible interval that also tells you that how much will they vary. Like for example, at the value 50, I can be 80 to 100% confident that I'll get a probability 1. So this is the Bayesian world. And how do we map it to the clustering? So the, like we have Gaussian distribution, is something also called a Dirichlet distribution. You can just check on Google. If you don't, just need to look at the math. But the interesting property is, in a Dirichlet distribution, the sum of all the values sum to 1. So because the weight vectors we want, they need to sum up to 1. So that's the property is given by Dirichlet. So these are the formulas you can look on Google. The idea is simple. If you draw any point, the sum of all the points should be 1. So if you take like a triangle, the point in the middle is basically equally distance from all the three corners. It's like 1, 3, 1, 3, 1, 3. And then point, maybe some other, could have a different weight, but sum up to 1. So you can imagine it's like a triangle on a plane. So with each point on the point 1 basically. So this is called a simplex. So this is a way how we can sample a weight vector for different values of k. And there is some parameters alpha, you can just look on internet. Different values alpha give different distribution. Like if you have small value alpha, you have more density at the corners. a bigger value, more density at the center. So I think, yeah, that's a normal thing. There's some interesting property of Dirichlet. You can read on internet. One interesting property is basically you can split a Dirichlet distribution. So if you have a dimension pi 1 and you can distribute by theta 1 minus theta, you'll get a new distribution with a split of b and 1 minus b. So what does it mean? Let's say we start with a two-dimensional Dirichlet. We set k equal to 2 in the beginning. And then we can split into two parts. We can split again into four parts and do it, let's say, for any k splits. And this k can also go to infinity. So this is the intuition behind the infinite Gaussian mixture model, that you can keep on splitting the weight vectors and have multiple of those distributions, and it will go recursively. And this whole process is called the Dirichlet process. So that's basically converting a fixed Gaussian mixture modeling to an infinite Gaussian mixture modeling. So I won't discuss maths anymore. So this you can also look from examples, like something called a Chinese restaurant process. So let's say you have empty tables in the beginning and people come in. Somebody can sit at any table. And there's a first guy, let's say sits on the first table. Then a new guy comes in. Either he can sit on the previous table and share the food with them or go to a new table. So that's how you can generate that. So let's say the first table he went, there's a probability 1 by alpha. Then at the second time, he can actually either use the same table and do a new one. There's different probabilities. So that's basically how you model a restaurant. And this is a Dirichlet process. I was talking earlier, basically. There's one more example called the Indian buffet. Yeah, sure. So like if you've been to like North India, I'm in Delhi. So the weddings are really fat weddings. The buffet over there, like 500 dishes over there at times. Yeah. So that's also like a Dirichlet process. Anybody can pick any dish and basically fill up their plate. And the dishes can attract lots number of people. So these are, again, common phenomenon. This is also a Dirichlet process. And you're actually going to observe one in the next of 10 minutes. The buffet out there is also a Dirichlet process. Yeah. So this is a simple simulation of this, how Dirichlet works, basically. It's how when you go to a random, this is like a tables over there. You're randomly coming to tables, and they're sitting over there. So you get a distribution out of that. So I think that's example. Let me show you this in a simple what's happening. I break it up. So these like called a stick breaking process. So choosing a cluster is like choosing these different clusters. So I can vary the distribution. So sum of all these sum up to one. So these are the weight vectors by choosing a cluster. So for different iterations, I can have different combinations. And for each combination, I can have a mixture of Gaussians. Like I can have Gaussian with three peaks, with two peaks, like two clusters, three clusters. And I can have multiple such combinations. So this is like a simulation of actually infinite GMM running in operation. So as you can see, the clusters are changing over here. And the number of points in the clusters are also reallocating. So this is like an infinite GMM in action. So you want to use these things. They are ready packages for that. So like PyMC3, TensorFlow has this progressive modeling packages. You can just run them. There's also a package in sklearn. So it's a simple thing. You can set a prior over there. If the prior is a Dirichlet distribution, you get a finite Gaussian mixture model. If the prior is a Dirichlet process, you get basically an infinite Gaussian mixture model. So this was the idea. But this is all complex, right? So progressive modeling has, it's good. It can model lots of real world things, but yeah, it's very computationally intensive. It is basically can't work on large data set. So it's good, but yeah, not practical. So that's where this applied data science comes in, and the automated clustering, this probably we can use. So based on the intuition we've developed so far, if we just think logically, we want to cluster a point. That was a main idea on a simple axis, basically. So instead of doing clustering, let's split the points first and find the dense region. So that could be more logical. So based on density, a continuity, if I want to split them, then out of that region, just get the PDF, like find the mean deviation of that. That would be easier. So bottom approach is more easier. So this is like a applied thing we are doing. And how we can do that? So it's a simple thing. To find the dense regions, you basically find a minimum distance to cluster them. So that's the idea. How do you find this d-min? I'll just cover in the next slide. But the idea is, if you're able to get the regions, and then most likely you'll get some regions which are not unimodal. They'll have multiple peaks. So you just check for that. Is it heavy tail or multimodal? If yes, go back, split it again. So you do it recursively, basically. What's a heavy tail? It's basically a statistic called excess kurtosis greater than 6. For normal distribution, it's equal to 3. And if it's more than 6, it's a heavy tail, basically. The tail is very heavy. Similarly, if you have more parameters like skewness, kurtosis, based on this, we can find bimodality. And so we can just do simple check. If you get a unimodal, if you don't get, just go back, split again. So simple recursive operation of finding the dense regions. And then probably, yeah, you get a list of these Gaussians. So that's a simple exercise. And finding d-mean, I think I covered this part in the last year's talk. I'll just summarize it quickly. So what's the idea? How do you find a d-min, the minimum distance to cluster? So let's say you have a dense clusters. If you can see, the intra-cluster distance would be pretty high over in a dense cluster. So there will be a peak in the beginning, then peaks later on. So the intra-cluster distance would most likely be the first peak in your PDF distribution, or the density plot over distance matrix. If the cluster goes a bit sparse, it will spread out. So this peak will go down, but still the first peak will represent the intra-cluster distance. So the idea is, if you can make assumption, you do a simple EDA. If there is a local dense regions in your data, you can find from an EDA, you can run this algorithm. So find the distance matrix and get the first peak. That's your basically the d-min you want to use for clustering. And you can use successive peaks for hierarchical clustering. That's a simple idea. So this is an example I showed last year. So this was like, I made this ODSC by these points, and I got like the first peak as the intercluster distance. And by using this d-min, I got all the clusters. That was a simple idea. And yeah, so I'm just done, yeah, wrapping it. Yeah. So this is the basically a simple idea to automate it. Just do a grid search on these d-mins. So it's like you want to find the minimum distance. You to smoothen the curve, you find the optimal curve by varying those curves. So simple idea is do a Fourier transform and just do attenuate the smoothing parameter. That's we get from Fourier transform basically, and do in a loop. So it's like simple like a grid search thing, and you can easily get all those parameters and maximize via score, like a log loss, and you get the best curve. So that's how you automate it, and yeah, you get those things. And eventually I think, yeah, these are the results. So that's it. This is one technique. Thank you. Yeah.